马来西亚大型中文房地产清谈节目，邀请上节目分享房地产的开讲嘉宾来自五湖四海，比如来自中国发展商的新华联集团代表。
在这里的投资呢，我们不只专注于把中国的居民带到来马来西亚，其实我们更想的是说把我们这20多年累积的这种经验那么带到来马来西亚。
来自新加坡旅游产业汇盛集团负责人。
什么东西都会搬的，但是旅游城啊这些就不会搬啊，古迹是不可能搬的。
来自台湾亚太国际地产代表。
你先看趋势，再看区域，然后再选地点。如果你这个部分你选对的话呢，你大概70%都错不了。
当然也有马来西亚的房地产领域的精英。
我自己也需要投资才能够真正的在房地产赚到一点钱。
不过是因为这是一个转机，如果你真的你已经是挺 stable 的，所以你已经是一个老板级的 OK 的。
我们也跟政府就是这个 MIDI 这个贸工部还有这个投资局 MIDA Matrix 啊，一起配合做很多这样"一带一路"啊。
踏入11月份，也是曾钻节目更国际化，制作组特意拉队到英国伦敦进行拍摄。隆重登场的国际重量级嘉宾就是《富爸爸穷爸爸》作家 Robert Kiyosaki。
Robert, it's our honor to have you in our show. But first of all, I believe the Malaysian public would like to know you for one thing. It's because of your book, Rich Dad Poor Dad. What inspires you to write about this book?
Well, Rich Dad, Poor Dad is a true story about my two fathers. My real dad was a PhD, head of education, government official. But he knows nothing about money. So he's the smartest guy in town, but he's poor. And then my rich dad was my best friend's father, and he was an entrepreneur, never went to school. So Rich Dad, Poor Dad is a story of what two fathers, one rich, one poor, one educated and poor, and one uneducated and rich, tell their two sons about money. So that's why I wrote Rich Dad, Poor Dad, because what's going on in the world today, we have this huge gap right now between the rich and everybody else. And there's many reasons for that, why the gap gets bigger and bigger.But one reason is our school system still has no financial education in schools. So 20 years ago, I wrote Rich Dad, Poor Dad because I could see this crisis coming. And this crisis is getting worse right now. You know, if there's too many poor people, that leads to rebellion and anarchy.
富爸爸穷爸爸是改编于作者亲身经历，这是他实实在在的成长经验。这本书在1999年4月在美国出版，仅仅半年时间就创下销售100万册的佳绩。中文版于2000年9月面世后，连续18个月蝉联全国图书销售排行榜第一名。之后，此书发行109个国家，总销量突破2900万册。《富爸爸穷爸爸》创造了通俗理财读物销售的神话，更有人号称全世界10万读者因阅读本书而改变了命运。
And I understand from your latest book, The Second Chance.And as well as your previous publications, you are actually predicting that as early as 2016, there may be a global economic crisis, right? You mentioned just now, wow, the rich and the poor, but is there any second chance for us at the moment? Why no?
No, it's up to the person.
Okay.
Look, I wrote a book called Rich Dad's Prophecy. I started it in 1999. Because I could see the markets topping. You know what I mean? They're going up, down, up, down, up, down. So I wrote that in 1999, and I published it in 2002, and I said the biggest crash was coming in 2016. I also said that there would be a crash prior to 2016, and that would be very, very big, and then 2016 would be the monster crash. So my predictions are on schedule. 2007, as you know, the Dow topped 14,000. And then it came down, and then Lehman Brothers went bankrupt, AIG went bankrupt, Goldman Sachs should have gone bankrupt, and Morgan Stanley. But that was, and so that was the warning that 2016 is coming. So the question is 2016 coming? Well, for millions of people, it already has. Because today, all across the world, you have rich, which is less than 0.5% in America, and everybody else.So the middle class in America is sliding into poverty. It's only going to get worse. So that's why I wrote Second Chance, but that's why I also wrote Rich Dad, Poor Dad, which came out in 1997. I could see this crisis coming. It's only going to get worse.
Wow.
Good news, isn't it?
It's good news for some. It's the best of time for the rich.
Yeah.
And it's the worst of time for the poor.
Well, for the middle class.
For the middle class.
See, the poor are really not that affected.
Okay.
Because they're already poor. But the middle class may hurt. You know, if you're used to having a nice lifestyle and all this, and suddenly it gets taken away, then you get upset, you know.
I see. So what separates, the financial education will be the key for the middle class to actually survive or even take advantage of this opportunity. And in our part of the world, Malaysia, we have been worshipped, I should use the word worship, because we believe that you actually introduced this concept of financial education to us. Before you, everyone was thinking that we have to work hard, we have to have a very good education before we can be successful in life. But after what you have written about in Rich Dad Poor Dad, it seems that we can actually achieve financial freedom by just acquiring the right type of assets. The right type of assets, do you have any secrets for us? What is the asset that you believe that will be able to let the middle class becoming exiting the rat race?
Well, the middle class really doesn't have a chance because of middle class values. And a poor person will never become middle class because of their poor values. And the only person who can become rich is somebody willing to change their values and what they think is important in their life. So like in most of my family, they're very middle class, they're poor. You know, they're master's degrees, PhDs. And they value the PhD. They value, I have a master's degree. And they value they have a good job. So as long as you value that, that's very middle class. So until your values change. So I only write for those who want to be rich. And those who want to be rich then say, well, maybe I've got to make some changes. The government's not going to change, but I got to change. So Rich Dad, Poor Dad, the Rich Dad Company, and everything I talk to are only to people who want to be rich. Most middle class people want to be secure. There's a very big difference between security and freedom. And I don't want a job. I don't want a savings account. I don't want to invest in the stock market, you know, and I don't want to be told what to do. So I travel the world, I do what I like, I invest all over the world because I want my freedom. So a rich person wants their freedom. We've seen it all over the world. There's a lot of people in Malaysia, because, you know, Malaysia reminds me very much of Hawaii. It looks like Hawaii.
It's a second home, I should say that.
Well, always the same, you know, you have the rich white guys, and then you have the Asians, and then you have the Hawaiians in Hawaii. And, you know, the Hawaiians are getting wiped out. I mean, they're getting creamed. And then the Asian guys getting their butts kicked by the white guys. You know, the white guys own everything out there. Chinese are doing good, though. Chinese are doing good. But anyway, so Malaysia and Hawaii are very much the same. But it has to do with what you want to do. You know, Hawaii right now has the highest homeless population in the United States. Highest per capita. More people are homeless today. But they still believe in going to school. You know, to me, that's really silly, you know? So the problem is growing worse, and that's, I only speak to those who realize they gotta make some changes. That's my story.
据美国 Money Rate 网站在2015年下半年对美国各州经济情况、就业数据和生活成本进行分析，发布了美国人最易生存及最难生存的州排行榜。美国生存最艰难的十个州中，排名第一的是夏威夷。
Particular case that I remember reading a book is about the rich does not work for money.
You got it. You're one of the first guys that got that.
Yes. Doesn't mean that we have to work for free, we don't get any paycheck, and just work for fun.
I work for free, I make millions.
There is a purpose to it. There must be a purpose before you can actually acquire assets. You don't work for the paycheck, is that right?
I don't know.
Yeah, you work for the financial freedom.
Yes.
The name of our show is called Brick to Diamonds. After hearing so many inspiring examples, you have any particular examples that can showcase how this turning brick and mortars into diamonds?
All over the world. You know, you look at the richest guys in the world, they didn't go to school.
Okay.
I mean, I'm not saying education is bad. You know, if you want to be a doctor or a lawyer, you got to go to school. Mm. You want to be a school teacher, you got to go to school. But you want to be rich, you don't have to go to school. Okay, but it means you learn something else. I'm still learning every day, but not what they're teaching me in school. So you look at Richard Branson, Sir Richard Branson, you know, he didn't finish school. Steve Jobs never finished school. Henry Ford never finished school. Edison never finished school. Walt Disney never finished school. Oprah never finished school. But it doesn't mean they didn't learn something. They learned something else. And what Rich Dad Poor Dad is about and book Second Chance is you have to want to learn something else. See, I don't want a job because the moment I have a job, I'm working for money. And if I work for money, the government taxes me. Yes. So you know who pays the highest taxes? The A students, doctors and lawyers.
Yes.
You know, and I was never smart. I was always stupid in school. So that's how my poor dad, you know, school teacher, PhD, Stanford University, all the credentials. He says, you're never going to be successful because I was a C student.
But you are smart. You are street smart.
No, but I studied with my rich dad.
I see.
So my rich dad says, you'll never be successful in the school system, and I'll never be successful in corporations. And he says, you definitely will not become a doctor or a lawyer because I'm not that kind of smart. I'm not academic smart. So rich dad says, you'll be better as an entrepreneur. And so I'm an entrepreneur, so I don't have a paycheck. And it drives most people crazy. Well, how can you survive without a paycheck? Well, I have cash flow. You see, I have income coming from all my real estate developments, all my oil wells, all my businesses, but I don't have a job. And so that's what I mean by the value system is I don't want a job, number one, because I'll get taxed, and number two, then I'd have to sit behind a desk. And I'm not that smart anyway. So there's very big differences. And so all I do is I go around the world, I talk to people about what my rich dad taught me and what school doesn't teach you. I'm not saying education's not important. I'm saying there's different types of education. So I learned the education that made Steve Jobs rich and Branson rich and rich dad rich.
I see. Just now you mentioned about one particular thing, the right type of education, as well as there is what we are asking for is actually how do you get involved in real estate? Do you still remember your first case of real estate acquisitions? Because everyone feels that you have a very different type of investment philosophy in real estate investment. I remember that...
What's so different about it? I don't flip properties.
That's correct, yes.
I know the people who flip properties, they're poor people.
I see.
You know, I mean, they're people who need the money. Mm. You see, I don't want that kind of money. I want income, I want cash flow. Mm. So, because if I flip property, I pay tax again.
Yes.
If I have cash flow, I pay no tax.
Yes, especially you can also use other people's money to buy for the
property,
right?
Let me just tell you this much, okay? That doesn't make sense to the average person. You have to understand that the problem with schools is they teach you there's right and wrong. Mm. The same thing you go to church, you go, well, this is right, that's wrong. Mm. Well, that's stupid thinking. That's really limited thinking. You have to think of education as a coin. You know, I cover this in Second Chance. I have a new video out called The Man Who Could See the Future. Intelligence or education is like a coin. You have heads on one side and tails on the other. On the edge, which is the third side, is where intelligence is found. So what I was taught to do was stand on the edge and not go right and wrong. You know, I don't really care if somebody is Christian or Muslim or Buddhist or this, you know, because people go to war over what religion you are. That's what we're fighting in the Middle East right now. It's really stupid. You know, if somebody wants to be a Muslim, fine. Somebody wants to be a Buddhist, fine. Somebody wants to be a Christian, fine. But our school system and our church system tells you there's right people and wrong people. That causes war. See, that's really ignorant. So what financial education is, I stand on the edge, okay? So you look at all the poor and middle class, they're all saving money.
Yes.
Yeah, and they're putting money into mutual funds and stocks and ETFs and all that. And all of that money funnels over to the rich, okay?
How does it happen? They are just doing what
they're told to do.
That's correct.
The right thing to do is save, get a job, save money, and invest for the long term in the stock market and get out of debt. You see, that's on the poor and middle class side. On the rich side, all these banks, you know, the banks are ripping everybody off. God bless them, you know. But so all this money flows to the banks, and everybody gets upset with the banks. Well, see, the banks need people like me. They need people like you. All this money, trillions of dollars, stacks up in the bank accounts, but bankers don't know anything about investing, you know? So they got to give it to somebody. So I stand on this side, I go and say, Mr. Banker, and I say, okay, Mr. Banker, you have all these trillions of dollars coming in, give it to me. So the poor middle class, the reason they're getting poor and the gap's getting wider is they're giving the money to the rich or the bankers, and then the bankers give it to the rich. I love this system. The trouble is, it's now so wide that we're going to have anarchy. We already have anarchy, you know, rioting in America. We have Ferguson, the blacks are rioting and all this stuff. But they never learned how to borrow money. You know, I borrow millions of dollars. And on the poor and middle class side, the school teachers and the preachers and the mothers and fathers say, oh, debt is bad. You see, that's a good and bad. You gotta cut that stuff out and see that all coins have three sides. So the money is flowing to me all the time. This year, 2015, I borrowed $300 million. Wow. Okay, that's not a lot of money, it's almost half a billion. How long would it take you to work for $300 million? Most guys can't make it.
That's right.
They can't make it. You know, in America, they're lucky to make $100,000 a year. But if I know my education, what financial education is, how do I take my banker's money that you gave the banker, I take it. It's in second chance. You know, bankers are giving me the money. So what I learned to do was how to take your money and make me rich. Okay, so you can sit there and say, oh, that's wrong. Well, you know, the poor middle class sit there. Bah, 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 bah. The school teachers are going. Bah, 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 bah. All the socialists are going. Bah, 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 bah. But the capitalists on this side are going, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. So our school system, our church systems, and our parents teach everybody to be on this side. They tell you to get out of debt. And on the other side of the coin, which they say is wrong, the bankers are giving it to me. So every time you put money into your mutual fund or your retirement account, you know, I just say thank you for your money. Because bankers have to give it to me, the capitalist. That's the way it is. Three sides, heads, tails, edge. So as a young boy, I stood on the edge. And I said, I want to be on this side, not that side. So it takes different education to be on this side.
Yes. This relates back to the original topic about the economic crisis.
Yeah.
You're all prepared for that. But to some people, they are very curious. I mean, if there's an economic crisis, why should they not be savings? For the savings and money to prepare for that. Because they feel that if there is actually an economic crisis, they should stop investing, they should stop borrowing money, they should actually concentrate in putting more money into the bank so that they can live longer.
That's their, like I said, it's their values.
Yes.
To me, that's stupid. You know, to them, it's smart. It's always three sides. They think it's smart, I think it's stupid. But when you look at the coin and you see the cash flowing from the poor and middle class to the bankers and then to the rich, it's in second chance.
Yes.
Really simple to see. So I know how to take that money and they give it to me. And guess what? Because they give it to me and I'm doing the banks a favor, I pay no tax.
That's correct.
But these guys pay tax. They pay tax on their savings and their retirements. It's funny.
So on top of academic educations, there are people with professional educations, but the most important that a lot of people actually forget is about the financial educations. Three elements in order for them to be fully educated.
Yeah.
And is in Asia nowadays, after being inspired by you, a lot of the Asians actually for the past 10 years has acquired a lot of real estate because they feel that real estate is the key for them to reach financial freedom. But is that an educated investment?
No.
A lot of people...
No, they think it's real. It has nothing to do with real estate. It has to do with education. What you're doing is acquiring education or experience. See, a lot of people lose money on real estate too.
That's right. They buy to flip, right? They don't look
for Well, not only that, they don't know a good deal from a bad deal.
I see.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
There's no guarantees.
Yes.
It's not just real estate. There's the number one asset that makes you rich is a business. The richest guys in the world own businesses.
That's right.
Number two is real estate. Number three is paper, which is stocks, bonds, mutual funds, ETFs. That's what the masses invest in most of all. Okay. Most retirement plans are in stocks, bonds, mutual funds, savings, ETFs, paper. And the last are commodities, like gold, silver, you know, water, food, shelter, stuff like that. So if you're going to invest in anything, then you got to invest in your education. So I don't want a job. So I had to invest in my education, how to be an entrepreneur. How do I start a company, raise the capital, and expand the money? Then the money generated from my business, how do I flow it into real estate? That's how I get rich. Real estate is debt. You see, the reason the banks give me so much money is not because of my business, but because my real estate holdings are so large, right? The banks want to give me money. They don't want to give you money for your startup.
That's right. Yeah, they need collaterals. They call that collaterals.
Or securities.
Yes.
So they love real estate. So I'm not really in real estate. I'm in debt because that's what the big banks want to give me money for is my debt. You know, they want the real estate so they can securitize it. Then they take my debt and then they securitize that debt and they sell that debt as an asset also. They call it CDOs, collateral debt obligations. A derivative. And the average person right now has no idea what I just said. You know, they don't know what a CDO is or MBS, mortgage-backed security. You see, to the bank, debt is the asset. But to you, mom and pop, your debt is a liability. But the bank takes debt and turns it into an asset. And that's why they like me. I'm the capitalist. These guys over here are socialists and communists. That's life. Which side do you want to be on?
So it must be a real estate that's bankable. Huh?
No, I'm trying to tell you it's your education that's valid. That's your asset.
I see.
You know, it's financial education. I know how to borrow money.
I see.
And the average person doesn't know how to. And the reason I can borrow so much money is I know good real estate from bad real estate. And then I go to my banker. You know, the average guy cannot borrow $100 million, but I borrowed $300 million this year. And the reason I borrowed $300 million was the banks took the interest rates from 5% to 2%. You know how much money that made me?
Wow.
You know, how much money did, you know,
you,
how much how much did I make?
You must be a very good position on negotiating the rates with the bank. It's no, I don't think a normal Malaysian would
do that.
That's right. Yeah.
And Malaysia has very loose lending laws.
Yes.
Malaysia is a great place to borrow money, by the way.
Okay.
But anyway, so I go to my banker and I say, well, I'll borrow more if you reduce my interest rates. The average guy who goes in there, they got credit card debt, they got home loan debt, they got auto debt. Banker doesn't want to talk to them. The banker does not want your savings because your savings cost them money. They've got to give your savings, your investment money to me, who will take large chunks of it and take down, you know, almost $1 billion worth of real estate. And they will give me great interest rates, all that, because I can borrow large chunks of it. And so it's knowledge, financial education up here that makes you rich. The average Malaysian, American, European, they buy, you know, $1 million property. They get all excited, you know, and then want to flip it because they don't know how to pay for it. You know, look at all these buildings here in London. I'd love to own all of them.
Wow.
You know, that's how you, no, I'd like to.
Yes.
But, the, you know, I'd have to go look around for a good one. There's a lot of real estate. There's a lot of real estate in Malaysia. But there's also more bad real estate than good real estate. And so it takes financial education, experience. You know, I started really small properties. My first property was $18,000. And now just work it up, work it up, work it up, work it up, work it up. So I've been doing it for 50 years, you know, since I was a kid. And that's how I make so much money. I don't flip from stocks to real estate to this. I know exactly my assets. I am in business. I'm an entrepreneur. I start companies. Then I hire CEOs. I don't want to run companies. Okay? And then with the profits from my companies, let's say I get $1, then I borrow $5 against that dollar.
Wow.
So I lever up 500%.
Yes.
Now, the average guy should not do that. But I tell people to start small. You know, start with that small house. Don't sell it. Learn to operate the rental property until you get really good. Then you buy your second house. Learn to operate. As you know, every deal is different. Every deal has got different problems to it. And that's how you learn. The average guy, they buy it for $1 million and flip it. I made $100,000.
国际理财大师 Robert Kiyosaki 对房地产有自己独特的见解，那对马来西亚的房地产趋势又有什么更直接的看法呢？下一集的点石成钻节目告诉你更多惊人的理财内幕。